الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم وعنده مفاتيح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هو ويعلم ما في البر والبحر وما تسقط من ورقة إلا يعلمها ولا حبة في ظلمات الأرض ولا رطب ولا يابس إلا في كتاب مبين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحاب سيدنا ومولانا محمد معدن الجود والكرم منبع العلم والحلم والحكم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبارك وسلم الحمد لله we gather once again to drink from the pond of wisdom of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam through the study and recitation of his ahadith, blessed words that have been transmitted to us by the best of nations, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, through Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi's beautiful collection Riyadh al-Saliheen. And alhamdulillah, we've reached the chapter of al-hath ala al-izdiyad min al-khayri fi awakhir al-umr. The chapter of increasing and increasing in good deeds in the last days of our life. This is the chapter, inshallah, we'll begin with. And inshallah, tawfiq of Allah, we'll move on to the next chapter also, which is the chapter of fi bayani kathrati turuqi al-khayr. The chapter of the various pathways of doing good deeds. The various pathways of doing good deeds and performing good a'mal for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Beginning from hadith number 112, inshallah. And we, alhamdulillah, have been blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by having this beautiful majlis of the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in these most noble days of Hajj, on the same day where no doubt the Hujjaj have gathered on the plains of Arafah and they have begged for their forgiveness from Allah, and they will be making their way towards Muzdalifah, where they will spend their nights, inshallah. So this is a very beautiful occasion. So alhamdulillah, we ask Allah that through the barakah of the ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he grants us forgiveness of our sins and he grants us an increase in our proximity to him, inshallah, in these blessed days of Dhul Hijjah. Without further ado, inshallah, we begin from hadith number 112. Babun fi baya fil hathi ala al-izdiyadi min al-khayr fi awakhir al-umr. Hafiz Awais, inshallah, you can read if you have the matan. Bismillah.
Are we not going to recite the ayat?
There's one ayah at the beginning of this chapter, so we can recite that one, and then inshallah we can move to the first hadith.
قال الله تعالى أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرَ وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. Allah Almighty says, did we not let you live long enough for anyone who was going to pay heed to reflect therein? And did not the warner come to you?
Okay, we'll just comment on that before we move on to the first hadith. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the chapter of increasing in our good deeds in the last part of our lives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أَوَلَمْ نُعَمِّرْكُمْ. Did we not extend your life, give you umr, give you a long enough life? مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ. That the one who is going to reflect can reflect and ponder over what their purpose is in this life. وَجَاءَكُمُ النَّذِيرُ. And did warners not come to you as well? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, يعني Allah ta'ala, he is telling us that he gave us numerous years for us to ponder and understand and realize what's going on in the world and realize our objective in this dunya. And it is for this reason Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said, ma'anahu awalam nu'ammirkum sittina sana. The meaning of have we not given you life so that you can ponder, a long enough life so you can ponder, is have we not extended your age to 60 so that you can ponder. And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, عُمْرُ أُمَّتِي مَا بَيْنَ سِتِّينَ وَسَبْعِينَ. The age of my ummah is between 60 and 70 on average. That's the average age of the ummatis of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu is telling us in this verse that what? That Allah has given us these 60 years, and that's the lifespan that he's given us so that we can ponder and reflect over our purpose and connect back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this is that age that Allah ta'ala has granted us, lifespan that Allah has granted us, 60. And He has granted us these years, مَا يَتَذَكَّرُ فِيهِ مَنْ تَذَكَّرُ, so that we can ponder, reflect, and understand our purpose in this dunya, connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Life is, and time is our most valuable asset, most valuable asset. And our age and our the days that we have in this life is something that every single second of it should be counted, and every single second of it should be valued, particularly if we go beyond the age of 40. Especially before the age of 40 as well, without a shadow of doubt, but especially before, after we go beyond the age of 40 or approach the age of 40. It is narrated that that Ahlul Medina kanu idha balagha ahaduhum 40 sana tafarraga lil'ibada. It's narrated that the people of Medina, when they would reach the age of 40, then they would separate. They would remove any excessive or extra activities from their life, and they would go towards the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would not waste time with anything which is of no benefit. After the age of 40, they would remain in ibadah. They would remain in ibadah. So this is an incredibly important age. And we will learn the importance of the age of 40 in the first hadith, which is explained in this chapter. So this is why Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayhi has made a chapter in this kitab here with regards to increasing our good deeds in the latter part of our lives. In the latter part of our lives. And this is why Imam Qatada rahimahullah from the Tabi'een, he says, "Wa طول العمر حجة." فنعوذ بالله أن نغتر بطول العمر. He said, a long age is an evidence for you, or an evidence against you. So we seek refuge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from being deceived by having a long lifespan. Yeah, what does this mean? What this means is a person, if they have a long life, it's an evidence against them on the Day of Judgment. Why? Because they were granted a long lifespan. They were granted 60 years, 70 years, 80 years to think, reflect, understand their haqiqah as a human being and a servant of Allah, and understand how to connect to Him and worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they didn't do that, that's an evidence against them. All that time you had and you wasted it chasing after your desires, and you didn't spend a moment to reflect, what are you doing on this dunya? So it's evidence against us on the Day of Judgment, he says, rahimahullah. And it's also an evidence for us, for a person, khiyarukum man طال عمره وحسن عمله. The best of you are those who have long lives and they have the most beautiful of deeds, he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So long life is a hujjah for you, it's a defense for you as well, if that long life is used for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the importance of valuing our age, valuing our lifespan, understanding that we have been given very limited years on this dunya, and utilizing them as best as possible. And the reality is, look, the reality is, we do not know about the next moment, the next breath. None of this is guaranteed. But a person should wake up to the reality of the matter, especially when they reach the age of 40. Especially when they reach the age of 40. Imam Mujahid rahimahullah has also mentioned, al-umr alladhi a'dhara Allah ila ibn Adam 40 sana. That age up to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the children of Adam, he's given them an excuse, meaning he pardons them, is the age of 40, Imam Mujahid says, rahimahullah, from the Tabi'een. Why? Because in youth, people are liable to make mistakes. You are full of energy. It's an age of foolishness. You do things without thinking. This is all part and parcel of youth. So in youth, mistakes happen. A person lacks life experience. A person lacks wisdom. All of these things a person lacks. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants his khas karam upon that individual. And we will talk about that as well. There's a hadith talking about in this chapter how Allah ta'ala may grant wisdom to those of small ages as well. But a person, when they become 40, you've been through difficulties in life which shape you. You've experienced the different aspects of life. You've experienced many different things. And then beyond that, then it is expected that your aql and your understanding has reached enough of a level that you should be able to realize your purpose as a servant before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Innama, if a person is reached 40 and 50 and they're still stuck on the PS3 or the PS4 or the PS5 nowadays, and they're still stuck on, you know, those same games that they were playing when they were 15 or 13 or 12, then something has gone terribly wrong. Something has gone terribly wrong. If we have the same frivolities in our life when we are that age, when we were children, and this is a calamity of our time, that that even those who are who have moved on in their age appeal to have the minds and the maturity of children, really, that they fail to wake up to their responsibility and their duty as a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even after reaching such an age, So our age is a priceless gem. It is the most valuable thing we've been granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is important that we use it in the correct way. So this is why the Imam rahimahullah has given us this chapter, the chapter of increasing our good deeds, in especially in our latter years, to make the most of our lives before we leave and go towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, the first hadith inshaAllah.
فالأول عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم قال أعذر الله إلى امرئ أخر أجله حتى بلغ 60 سنة رواه البخاري. حضرت أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه reports that the Prophet صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم said Allah has excused himself in the case of a man whose term he extends until he reaches 60 years of age.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala excuses a person, the case of a man, until they reach the age of 60, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Okay, so this is the age which after which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not leave, does not give any excuse. And the meaning of Allah ta'ala giving them excuses is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't leave any sabab, any cause, any reason for the person after the age of 60, that any excuse that they can present in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the meaning of this is what? أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُعَاقِبُ إِلَّا بَعْدَ الْحُجَّةِ. Allah does not punish except after an evidence, except after a clear evidence which is presented against the person who is stood in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And before 60, a person can present any, they can present something, you know, it was my foolishness, Ya Rabb, it was my lack of wisdom, Ya Rabb, I was tricked into doing it, I didn't understand the reality of the matter, Ya Rab. All of these things can be made. But once you've reached that age of maturity, a person understands what is harmful, what is beneficial. A person understands what is right, what is wrong. A person understands what is all of these things, and so there remains no excuse in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala does not pardon them. Hence, in another hadith, just to give you an example of what is meant by this. In another hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to us how the Shaykh Zani, old man who is engaged in zina, an old man who continues to engage in zina, is amongst the most despised people in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this very reason, that they have reached an age where they should be singling themselves out for the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and earning their forgiveness from him before they die, getting ready to meet their Lord, not that they do away with the final years of their life in following their desires. So Allah ta'ala gives excuses to his ibad up until the age of 60, he has said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And after that, there is no udhr. After that, there is no excuse which a servant can hold by, and they are liable to punishment in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it doesn't mean that a person can sin before 60 and it's all forgiven. Yeah, and you've got until 60 to enjoy yourself. It does not mean that. What it means is that a person, has no excuse to present in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after 60. And so they will not be pardoned. Before 60 they may have. After 60 there is no excuse which they can present in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We come now then to the next hadith. Hadith number 130. Yani the old age is the age in which a person receives wisdom. And this is why the ulama rahimahullah, they say what? Yani ta'allam قَبْلَ أَن تَتَصَدَّرْ. Yani before a person reaches leadership, they should study. تَعَلَّمْ قَبْلَ أَن تَتَصَدَّرْ. Study and learn understand your place as your servant before Allah and Allah Ta'ala as your creator before you take the post of sadara, of leadership, or being at the head of any nation, or at the head of any community, or at the head of any society, or taking any role of authority, learn before you do so. And this is what the ulama have said. And it's incredibly important that we understand this. And so what is assumed is that a person achieves this level of understanding in the latter years of their life. Hence why after that age, there is no excuse for them. However, there are occasions where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may grant a young person a great wisdom. And we have examples of that from the Sahaba. And we will read an example of that in the next hadith which we read now. Hadith number 113. Bismillah.
No, just the English.
The Arabic, inshallah.
An Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma qal, kana Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu yudkhiluni ma'a ashyaqi badarin. Faka'anna ba'adahum wajada fi nafsihi. Faqala, lima yadkhul hadha ma'ana walana abna'un mithluhu. فقال عمر إنه من حيث علمتم فدعاني ذات يوم فأدخلني معهم فما رأيت أنه دعاني يومئذ إلا ليريهم قال ما تقولون في قول الله إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح فقال بعضهم أمرنا نحمد الله ونستغفره إذا نصرنا وفتح علينا
إذا نصرنا
وفتح علينا وسكت بعضهم فلم يقل شيئا فقال لي أكذلك تقول يا ابن عباس فقلت لا قال فما تقول قلت هو أجل رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم
أعلمه الله له
أعلمه الله له قال إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح وذلك علامة أجلك فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا فقال عمر رضي الله عنه ما أعلم منها إلا ما تقول رواه البخاري.
Oh, the translation. Bismillah.
Sayyidina Ibn Abbas said, Sayyidina Umar used to admit me together with the sheikhs of Badr, and it seemed that some of them were annoyed by that and said, why does he admit this? Why does he admit one with us when we have sons of his age? Sayyidina Umar said, you know well where he is from. So one day he summoned me and had come with me in with them. And I thought that he'd summoned me that day to show me to them. He said, what do you say about the words of Almighty when Allah's help and victory have arrived? Some of them said, we are commanded to praise Allah and to ask his forgiveness when he helps us and makes us victorious. Some of them were silent and did not say anything. He said to me, is that what you say, Ibn Abbas? I said, no. He said, so what do you say? I said, it is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasallam being informed of the end of his lifespan. He said, when Allah's help and victory have arrived, and that is a sign of the end of your lifespan. Then glorify your Lord's praise and ask his forgiveness. He is the ever-returning. Sayyidina Umar said, no one knows better than what you say.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to include Abdullah ibn Abbas in the majlis of the shuyukh of Badr. Yani, these were those sahaba who took part in the battle of Badr who were elderly. And they were involved in the circle of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu for mashwara. So he would consult them. They were part of his council which he would consult. And they were elder in their age and they were well knowledgeable and they were experienced amongst the sahaba. So that's why he had them in his council. So these were those sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, those that took part in the battle of Badr, the elder sahaba. But when they saw Abdullah ibn Abbas coming and joining in this majlis, and he was a young sahabi, Sayyidina ibn Abbas was very young when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left the dunya. But he had with him the dua of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma allimhu ta'wil. Oh Allah, give him the knowledge of the book. Oh Allah, teach him the ta'wil of the Quran, the meanings of the kitab. This is the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for ibn Abbas. So age does not matter where the fadl of Allah ta'ala takes place. Age is not a consideration. And so, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu an, he made this complaint from the Sahaba. Why is Sayyidina Umar involving this young man in our majlis when he is younger as our children? And look at Sayyidina Umar's response radiallahu an. He said, "Innahu min haythu alimtum." You know well where he's from. Yani, what do you mean where he's from? He's from the Bayt al-Nubuwa, min Bayt al-Nubuwa, wa manba' al-ulumi wa masdar al-ara'i al-sadida. He's from the household of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Abbas is the son of the uncle of Rasulullah. So Sayyidina Umar was telling that you know where he's from. He's from the household of the Messenger. So dare you complain against a person who's from the household of the Messenger. And that's the fountain of all knowledge, the household of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's from there. So he invited Sayyidina Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma one day to show why he's included him in the council and why he sat him down amongst these great Sahaba in the council. So after calling him, he asked the question then, what do you all say about the Surah An-Nasr? Allah Ta'ala says, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. Allah Ta'ala says, when the help of Allah comes and the victory. What is your understanding of this verse of the Quran? And they all gave, some of them, they gave their opinions. One of them said, what? It means that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah Ta'ala has commanded us that when we must praise Allah and seek His forgiveness when we are granted victory and we are granted help by Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he asked, oh Ibn Abbas, is that what you say? Do you have the same opinion? And he said, no, that's not my opinion. So what is the opinion of Tarjuman al-Quran Ibn Abbas? He said, it is this surah is referring to the lifespan of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The lifespan of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when this verse was revealed, he began to cry. He began to cry. Because they understood the deeper meanings of these ayat. He understood that when the victory of Allah comes, the duty of the Rasul has finished. If the duty of the Rasul has finished, that means his days amongst us are numbered, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will lose his company. So they understood the meanings of these ayat. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, no, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ, when the victory of Allah comes and the help of Allah comes, it means the lifespan of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَعَلَّ ذَلِكَ لِدَلَالَتِهَ عَلَى تَمَامِ الدَّعْوَةِ وَكَمَالِ أَمْرِ الدِّينِ. Yani, when Allah says the help of Allah has come and the victory has come, what does it mean? It means the completion of the da'wah nabawiyyah, the completion of the prophetic invitation and the completion of the deen. That is the meaning of إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ, when the help of Allah comes to you and the victory, the completion of the deen. The same as Allah Ta'ala when He says, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ, on this day we have completed your religion. أَوْ لِأَنَّ الْأَمْرَ بِالْإِسْتِغْفَارِ يُنَبِّهْ عَلَى دُنُوِّ الْأَجَلِ لِأَنَّهُ يَكُونُ فِي خَوَاتِمِ الْأُمُورِ. And the other reason why this ayah indicates towards, or this surah indicates towards the ending of the lifespan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is because Allah Ta'ala says, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. Praise, declare the praises of your Lord, and وَاسْتَغْفِرْ, seek istighfar. And the command for istighfar indicates what? Indicates that the lifespan is coming to an end. Why? Because this seeking of forgiveness and istighfar is something that needs to happen. It should happen all the time, constantly, but especially towards the end of a person's lifespan. Towards the end of a person's life. Yani, at the end of a person's life, they should be the years that a person increases in their rujoo and their istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, وَلِذَا كَانَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَسْتَغْفِرُ بَعْدَ صَلَاتِهِ وَإِذَا خَرَجَ مِنَ الْخَلَىٰ وَإِذَا أَفَاضَ وَلِذَا سُمِّيَتْ سُورَةُ التَّوْدِيعِ. It's for this reason that the Prophet ﷺ, after this surah was revealed, he ﷺ would constantly do istighfar after every salah, and he would do it after coming, even after leaving the bathroom, and in all affairs, he ﷺ would constantly do istighfar. And this is why, another reason why this surah, Surah An-Nasr, is also called Surah Tawdi', from the word wida', is the surah of bidding farewell, the surah of bidding farewell. That's why it's called that, because it was revealed to indicate to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that it is time for istighfar, because the time of leaving the dunya, zahir dunya, has come close, O Messenger sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And this is why Imam Abu Hayyan al-Andalusi rahmatullahi alaihi, from the great scholars of tafsir, Maliki scholar, he writes that what? This surah, Surah Al-Nasr, was revealed in the Ayyam al-Tashriq bimina fi Hajjat al-Wida. It was revealed in the Ayyam al-Tashriq, which are coming for all of us, in Mina, in the final farewell Hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived 80 days. Fa'asha ba'dahuha 80 yawman. He lived 80 days after this surah was revealed, sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So it was a surah which showed the lifespan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was coming to an end. فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفر إنه كان توابا. فكان صلى الله عليه وسلم بعد نزول هذه السورة يكثر من قوله سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اللهم اغفر لي. After this surah was revealed, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would also increase in his ذكر of سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اللهم اغفر لي. He would make this dua constantly, صلى الله عليه وسلم, as we will read in the next ahadith. So we learn from this hadith of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم two important things. Number one, we learn that it is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He grants wisdom and He grants ilm and He grants fadila to people when they mature mentally and spiritually, and when they mature mentally and spiritually, then Allah ta'ala grants them fadila. However, when Allah ta'ala wants to, He may grant fadila to people even in their youth, like the example of Sayyidina Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, who stood amongst the shuyukh of Badr, and he was able to give tafsir of the Quran, which they were unable to give. This is ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. This is the fadl of Allah, and He may give it to whoever He wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the qudra of Allah and the fadl of Allah. As for the sunnah of Allah, it is that He grants fadila to people after they strive and struggle and they earn knowledge and wisdom from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He said, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. Knowledge and understanding of wisdom only come through study, He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Only come through study. And it's a calamity of our time that people put themselves forward for leadership and put themselves forward for issuing religious verdicts and the teaching of the deen, without having studied or without having understood one harf of the deen of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a problem that we should avoid. And not only after an individual has studied with the shuyukh and be granted ijazah and they have achieved a capability after which their teachers will inform them and instruct them to take the position of teaching the deen, then an individual should go out and issue. Otherwise, nisfuddin la adri, half of the religion is to say I don't know. And this is something that all of us would do well in remembering. Yani look at the from amongst the shuyukh of Badr here, the Rawi Ibn Abbas, he says that what some of them said nothing. Sakata ba'duhum falam yaqul shay'a. The shuyukh of Badr. Okay, did they not know the tafsir of these ayat? Why were they silent? Out of ihtiyat, radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. Out of caution, not to falsely ascribe something to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, this is one lesson that we learned from this hadith. Number two, we learned from this hadith that one of the greatest a'mal that a person can do throughout their life, and especially towards the end of their life, is the istighfar, to make istighfar. For this is from the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After he received khabar of his passing, that his passing is to come soon, he increased in his istighfar sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. So this is an amal which we should do, mulazama of istighfar daily, even if it's a short number, but do mulazama of making istighfar daily. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wasallam. We come to the next hadith inshallah, hadith number 114.
عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت ما صلى رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم صلاة بعد أن نزلت عليه إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح إلا يقول فيها سبحانك ربنا وبحمدك اللهم اغفر لي.
Okay, translation of this one.
So سيدة عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها said after the verse إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح, Allah's help and victory have arrived, was sent down on him, the messenger of Allah صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم not pray his prayer without saying Glory be to you, our Lord, and with your praise, O Allah, forgive me.
Subhanaka Rabbana wa bihamdika, Allahumma ghfirli. He would make this prayer in his salah. Okay, we read the next one as well, and then after that, they just say other versions of the same narration. So, fi riwayat fi sahihain anha kana.
كان رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم يكثر أن يقول في ركوعه وسجوده سبحانك اللهم ربنا وبحمدك اللهم اغفر لي يتأول القرآن معنى يتأول القرآن أن يعمل ما أمر به في القرآن في قوله تعالى فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفر. In the variant in the two Sahih collections from her, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم used to say after in his bowing and prostration, glory be to you, our Lord, and with your praise, O Allah, forgive me, interpreting the Qur'an.
Okay, the meaning of interpreting... Bismillah, continue.
It says, the meaning of interpreting the Qur'an is doing what is commanded in the Qur'an in the words of Almighty. Glorify your Lord's praise and ask his forgiveness.
Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the rest of the riwayat are all based on this. So the Prophet Sayyidah Aisha, she says that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, after Idha Ja'a Nasrullah was revealed and indicated to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that his lifespan is coming to an end, every salah he would pray, he would say in the sajda and the ruku, Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika, or Subhanaka Allahumma Rabbana wa bihamdika Allahumma ghfirli. There are different variants. Another one, Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, or Subhanallah wa bihamdihi astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayk. Different variants, but anyone can be recited. Sayyidah Aisha asked the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, why are you doing this, O Messenger? And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, my Lord has told me, إِنِّي سَأَرَى عَلَامَةً فِي أُمَّتِي فَإِذَا رَأَيْتُهَا أَكْثَرْتُ فِي قَوْلِ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَبِحَمْدِهِ أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْهِ. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, my Lord has informed me that I will soon see a sign that will show me that I need to increase in reading these kalimat, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Astaghfirullah, these kalimat. And he said, I've seen that sign. And what was that sign? It was the revelation of the surah, Idha Ja'a Nasrullah. This was that sign which told the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, now is the time to make istighfar and increase. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam would read these kalimat, Subhanakallahumma, Subhana Rabbana, Subhanaka Rabbana wa bihamdika Allahumma ghfirli. He would read these kalimat in the ruku and the sujood of his salah. In the ruku and the sujood of his salah in his last year, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Other than Subhana Rabbi al-Azim and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, he would read this. Subhanaka Allahumma Rabbana wa bihamdika Allahumma ghfirli. He wouldn't read Subhana Rabbi al-Azim and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. He would read this instead. Now, let's look at the wording first that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used. First, he would say, Subhanaka Allahumma, glory be to you, O Allah. And Subhan means what? It means Tanzihan laka. Amma la yaliku bika min kulli naqs. Subhan means glorifying Allah and praising Allah and removing from Allah all that which is not suitable for His excellence, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. This is the meaning of Subhan. It means to declare Allah Ta'ala to be free from any minute deficiency, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. This is the meaning of Subhana. So he would say, Subhanaka, you are free of all deficiencies which are not suitable for you. Then he would say, Wabi Hamdika, and your praises, Ya Rabb. So the Prophet ﷺ would mention the tasbih first and then the tahmid. He would mention Subhanallah first, then Alhamdulillah. He's teaching why? Because Subhanallah is to remove any deficiencies from Allah, and Alhamdulillah is to praise Allah for all of His Sifatul Kamal, all of His beautiful attributes. And before you decorate and beautify, you first cleanse and purify. Before you decorate and beautify, you cleanse and purify. So before we beautify and glorify and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we first cleanse and purify our belief and our heart and our tongues and our minds from anything which is not deficient for, which is not suitable for the Zat of Allah, by saying He is free of all deficiencies. Then we praise Him, Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we negate all deficiencies, then we establish all beauties. This is why he would say, Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. All praise be to you, glory be to you, and all praise be to you in this order. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. It's a very beautiful dhikr he would make. And then he would say, Allahumma ghfirli. Then Allah forgive me. Why Allah forgive me at the end? Because the adab of dua and the adab of istighfar is that before you ask Allah to forgive you, you praise Him. You praise Him. You sing His praises, just like a slave in the court, a beggar in the court of the king. What do? If they want the king to bless them with something, they praise, flatter the king, praise the king. And so when we are in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seeking our forgiveness, we do the same. We praise Him, we glorify and exalt His name with all of that which is suitable for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we seek our forgiveness from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying istighfar for? We've explained this previously, I will explain it again. His istighfar sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not for any dhanb or any forgiveness, but rather it is for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's his humility before Allah in him expressing that he has fallen short of the maqam of ubudiyah, which is suitable for the dhat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any makhluk, regardless of their shan, even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they remain as a creation of Allah. Therefore, they cannot, by their very nature of being a creation, they are limited. And Allah ta'ala's praises and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beauties are without limit, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So by definition, no creation will be able to fulfill the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rububiyah. And so it is not for any dhanb that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is seeking forgiveness. No sin. But he's seeking forgiveness because he is, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is talking about his own, how he feels before his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a creation before his Lord, how he feels sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So this is the istighfar of the messenger. So why then do we in our prayer say subhana rabbiyal a'la and subhana rabbiyal azim in ruku' sujood? Or can we say subhanakallahumma bihamdika allahumma ighfirli in our ruku' and in our sajda? And the reason why we don't read these words in our ruku' and our sajda, the imam explains in the commentary, he says wajhu adami akhdhi al fuqaha bi qadiyati hadha al hadith annahu yaqulu fi al ruku' subhana rabbiyal azim wa fi al sujood subhana rabbiyal al duna ma dhukira fi hadha al hadith ما أن ما ذكره هو ما واظب عليه طول عمره وغيره مما ضمه إليه تارة واقتصر عليه أخرى. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited this adhkar and this recitation in his prayers sometimes, yani in the latter part of his life. As for Subhana Rabbi al-Azim and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, what we recite in our prayer, this is what he recited in his whole life, sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. So that is what should be recited in the prayer, therefore. And especially for the Ahnaf, for the Hanafis, reciting that which is warid in the Sunnah, this is necessary for us. That tasbih which is warid in the Sunnah is necessary for us. In the Nawafil, a person may increase in their in what they recite in the Ruku' and the Sajda, for example. So if a person wants to recite these Adhkar in the Nawafil prayers, whilst they are in the Ruku' and the Sajda, they may do so. So in the Nafil prayers, whilst they are in the Sajda, whilst they are in the Ruku', they can recite Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika Allahumma ghfirli. However, in the Fara'id, they should stick to Subhana Rabbi al-Azim and Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. So this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in his latter part of his life, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, increasing in his istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa taala. So this is what we should also do in our latter years, increase in our istighfar in front of Allah subhanahu wa taala. Okay, hadith number 115. Bismillah.
عن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه قال إن الله عز وجل تابع الوحي على رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم قبل وفاته حتى توفي أكثر ما كان الوحي متفق عليه. So Sayyidina Anas said that Allah Almighty made continuous revelations to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم up until the time of his death, so that when he صلى الله عليه وسلم died, the revelation was at its most abundance.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's wahi in the latter part of his years increased. It was continuous. Before, prior to this, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had certain periods where he did not receive revelation. There was a fatratul wahi, periods of gaps in revelation for numerous wisdoms and numerous reasons. But in the latter years of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the wahi was continuous. And that is in order for what reason? In order for the litakammul al-shari'ah. وَلَا يَبْقَى مِمَّا يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ بِهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. So in order to complete the ahkam of the sharia, Allah Ta'ala increased and the wahi was continuous upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so that the rulings of Islam could be given, so that the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam could return to al-Rafiq al-A'la, to return to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. So that is why the wahi was continuous in his last days, Sallallahu Alaihi Wa Alihi Wa Sahbihi Wa Sallam. Okay, next hadith, hadith number 116.
الخامس عن جابر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم يبعث كل عبد على ما مات عليه رواه مسلم.
الله أكبر.
سيدنا جابر reported that the messenger of Allah صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم said every slave of Allah will be raised up according to what he had been doing when he died.
Allahu Akbar. Every servant of Allah will be raised in accordance to what they have died. So this is incredibly important. This is why good deeds in the last days of our life are incredibly important, because whatever we die on is how we will be raised. Hatta yub'athu sahibul mizmar wa mizmaruhu fi yadi. The Imam, he says, even the people who play instruments, whilst they if they are playing that instrument and they die, they will be raised whilst they have that instrument in their hand, he says, rahimahullah. This is the reality of the matter. People will be raised in the same state that they die. ففيه تحريض للإنسان على حسن العمل وملازمة السنن المحمدية في سائر الأحوال. Therefore, it is necessary for us to what? Have beautiful deeds and hold fast to the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all cases. ليموت على تلك الحالة الحميدة فيبعث كذلك. So that we die in that state and we are raised in that state. So this is incredibly important, so that we live our lives in a way, in such a way that we are ready to die and meet our Lord at any moment, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, we finished the chapter of this chapter. We move on to the next chapter. باب في بيان كثرة طرق الخير. The chapter of the various pathways of good deeds, the various pathways of good deeds. So this is a very beautiful chapter, and it tells us how in Islam there are numerous ways which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us in order to please Him and earn His rida. So we read the ayat at the beginning of the chapter first, inshallah. Bismillah. If you translate it one by one.
Allah Almighty says, whatever good you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows it.
Hmm.
وَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَمَا تَفَعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرِي يَعْلَمُهُ اللَّهُ. And Allah Almighty says, whatever good you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows it. وَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ. And Allah Almighty says, and whoso doeth good as atom's weight will see it then.
Hmm.
وَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَلِنَفْسِهِ. And Allah Almighty says, whoever acts rightly, it is to his own good.
Okay, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. These ayat, all of them, you will notice, they are all, the ma is used. ما تفعلوا من خير فإن الله بيعلم وما تفعلوا من خير يعلمه الله. This ma comes for the meaning of generality, umum. So it means, whatever good you do, that could be any good, from spending in the way of Allah, salah, zakat, sawm, hajj, anything. Any good you do, ما تفعلوا من خير. Whatever good you do, Allah will know it. Whatever good you do, Allah is well aware of it. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَى. Whoever does any good. خَيْرًا here is a common noun, nakira. It's a common noun in the Arabic language. When you have nakira, في سياق when you have nakira mentioned like this, with the tanween, then this also gives the meaning of what? It gives the meaning of generality, because it's nakira fi siyaq al-shart. It's a common noun which is mentioned in a shart, in a conditional sentence. Whenever a common noun is mentioned in a conditional sentence, it means umum, it means generality. So may ya'mal mithqala dharra, whoever does any atom's worth of good, they will see it. It could be any good, spending in charity, even a small amount, smiling at somebody, helping somebody with carrying their heavy goods, all of whatever good you do, you'll be rewarded for it, Allah is saying. So that's why these ayat are all revealed, because they all indicate towards that generality of meaning. That generality of meaning, that could be any good deed, and Allah will reward it. Okay, so the chapter of the numerous pathways of good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His wisdom and from His hikmah, is that He has obligated for the human beings numerous different ways of pleasing Him. We have the five pillars, and then beyond the five pillars, there are numerous good deeds which a person can perform. Numerous good deeds which a person can perform. And this is for a reason. And the reason for this is, Ibn Ata'illah al-Iskandari rahmatullahi alayhi explains, لَمَّا عَلِمَ مِنْكَ الْمَلَلْ لَوَّنَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْوَاءَ الطَّاعَاتِ. Ibn Ata'illah, he says, Allah Ta'ala, since He knows that human beings become tired and fed up and bored very easily. For that reason, Allah has given you various different ways of obeying Him and pleasing Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah knows the tabi'ah of the human being. Some people have the ability and have the tabi'ah in them that they can learn the deen and they teach the deen. And that is where they find it easier. And so that is a path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them. Some people have been granted a very generous heart. And so they find it easy to spend in the way of Allah. That is a path of goodness to them. Some people have been given the ability that they find their ladha in their salah. They can stand in qiyam. That is a path of goodness to them. So Allah has given numerous different acts of worship for us so that we don't become fed up. We don't become tired. And we have various ways of pleasing Him and earning our forgiveness from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's great wisdom in Allah ta'ala obligating numerous different things. And Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala remarked on this beautiful reality. He looked at those who, Imam Malik we know was the great Imam of Medina, memorized over 1 million ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the founder and the formulator of the Maliki's madhab. He is an ocean from the oceans of knowledge, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has praised him in ahadith as well. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there will come a time where people will travel on the backs of camels seeking knowledge, and they will find nobody more knowledgeable than the scholar of Medina. And Imam Suyuti rahmatullahi alayhi says, this is hadith is referring to Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi. So Imam Malik rahimullah, he says something very beautiful. He says, look, people asked him, they said, look, you spend your whole day teaching hadith to the ummah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What about those people who are spending their whole days making dhikr and performing salah? What about those? And Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi said, inna allaha qassama baynakum akhlaqakum kama qassama baynakum arzaqakum. Allah has divided and has given to people, He has given them individually their own character, just like He has given them their own provision subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning what? Meaning everybody has their own ability to give their own good in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Allah has given me this ability of serving the deen of Rasulullah by preserving the knowledge of the messenger and passing it on to the generations which will come. Allah has given them the ability to pray and to remember Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't think that, I do not see that they are any better than me, and neither do I see that I am better than them. But rather, everybody has their own path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Imam Malik rahimullah said. And this was his humility. And why was it his humility? Because Imam Malik used to stay awake all night in salah anyway. He used to stay awake from Isha to Fajr in salah anyway. So it wasn't like he was short on the nawafil and only the teacher of ahadith. No, he had both. But he was explaining a principle here that Allah ta'ala has given various ways of pleasing him and attaining his rida subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is his karam upon the believers. For some people are not able to do certain actions. They don't have the ability. Not everybody has the ability to learn and teach deen in detail, such that they can benefit the ummah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this way. Not everybody has the ability to give sadaqah in abundance. They don't have the wealth. Not everybody has that ability. Not everybody has the ability to perform hajj every year or even once in their lifetime. And so Allah has made numerous different ways of pleasing Him so that nobody is left out and everybody has their own path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So explaining this reality, we have numerous ahadith in this chapter inshallah, which we will cover, which will explain to us this reality that Allah ta'ala has granted us numerous ways of pleasing Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we start with hadith number 117 inshallah. Bismillah.
عن أبي ذر جندب بن جنادة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قلت يا رسول الله أي الأعمال أفضل؟ قال الإيمان بالله والجهاد في سبيله. قلت أي الرقاب أفضل؟ قال أنفسها عند أهلها وأكثرها ثمنا. قلت فإن لم أفعل؟ قال تعين صانعا أو تصنع لأخرق. قلت يا رسول الله أرأيت إن ضعفت عن بعض العمل؟ قال تكف شرك عن الناس فإنها صدقة منك على نفسك. متفق عليه.
الله أكبر. بسم الله. Translation.
Abu Dhar Jundub ibn Junada radiyallahu ta'ala anhu said, I asked the Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, which action is best? He replied, belief in Allah and jihad in his way. I said, what is the best kind of setting free? He replied, that of the person most valued in the eyes of his people and the one with the highest price. I asked, what if I cannot do that? He replied, help the poor or those who cannot do anything for themselves. I said, Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, what about someone who is too weak to do anything? He said, withhold your evil from other people. That is sadaqah from you to yourself.
Okay, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Very beautiful hadith narrated by Sayyidina Abu Dhar al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala. And we've already talked about Abu Dhar and his, how he's an imam of zuhud and taqwa from the sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in. So he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, what are the best of actions? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, al-imanu billah wal-jihad fi sabili. Number one, believing in Allah. And number two, jihad in his way. These are the two best actions in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After belief in Allah, jihad in his way. Yani, jihad against our own nafs and jihad against those who attempt to create corruption in the land and those who attempt to spread disunity and destroy the harmony and tranquility of society. Jihad is against such people. So, jihad against them in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where a person's life and a person's wealth are given in the way of Allah to establish harmony in society. Inna Allah ashtara min al-mu'minina anfusahum wa amwalahum bi anna lahum al-jannah. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran that Allah has purchased the life of the believers. Allah has purchased the life and the wealth of the believers in exchange for paradise. So jihad is a great amal, a great action of reward in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the greatest form of action. As for a person who fights and they are only fighting to satisfy their own nafs, or they are fighting on the false pretense of working for the deen or struggling for the deen of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whilst their a'mal and their aqwal are far away from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the likes of ISIS and other false people who ascribe themselves to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and have nothing to do with him, their action is not jihad, their action is a crime. And it will be taken to account by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jihad is not what is only about establishing harmony in society and establishing justice. It has nothing to do with Allah ta'ala and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are free from the actions of such criminals. So, this is the best action, al-iman and jihad fi sabilillah. فَقُلْتُ أَيُّ الرِّقَابِ أَفْضَلِ Ya Rasulullah, he said, tell me which setting free is the best. Slavery was something which was existent in the Arab society. So he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, which type of setting free is the best? And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged or put the foundations for the ending of slavery. And he did this in a very wise way. He did this by encouraging the freedom of slaves and the equality of the slaves in society. So encouraging their freedom. This is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and explaining the rewards of freeing the slaves and even marrying the slaves and teaching the slaves after you have set them free. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged all of this, and this was how he began changing the mentality of the Arabs. And moving them away from the practice of slavery, which is an awful, awful practice. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, which is the best type of setting free? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, the most valuable, that servant who is the most valuable to the people and the one who is the most expensive. And why? Why is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that? Because, first of all, if a person, when a person frees another individual, if they spend more money to free that slave, then that money is all sadaqah in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the more you spend in the way of Allah, the more pleased Allah becomes with you. لَن تَنَالُ الْبِرَ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُ مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ You will not achieve piety, Allah says, until you spend that which you love. So the more you spend, the closer you are to Allah. So if slaves are expensive, you spend more to free them, then you are forgiven. Hence why Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, before the migration to Medina, we know that Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was responsible for freeing so many hundreds of slaves. So many of them. He had great wealth, great amount of wealth. He used more than 2/3 of his wealth freeing slaves from the Quraysh so that they could accept Islam and join the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So freeing slaves in this way, even if it means giving money, giving excessive amounts of money, doing it because that money is all in the way of Allah, and you are giving somebody their life back by purchasing their freedom. You are giving them their life back. Hence, it is a great charity in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu was purchased by Abu Bakr, when he was being whipped and tortured by Umayyah, Sayyidina Abu Bakr came and freed him and paid money for him. And Umayyah, he said, you've paid me this money. You've overpaid. I would have accepted much less for Bilal. He's useless. He means nothing. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr, he said, no. Even if you charged, a huge amount of gold pieces, I would have given them to you for Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, that the greatest setting free is that which you put the most money in, because spending more in the way of Allah, this is beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, fa'in lam af'al, if I'm not able to do any of these things, yani I don't have wealth, so I'm unable to buy somebody, I'm unable to free someone, I'm unable to give excessive amounts to charity, I'm unable to do jihad fi sabilillah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, tu'inu sani'an, aw tasna'u li akhraq. Okay, tu'inu sani'an. If you can't spend in the way of Allah, then tu'inu sani'an. Help a person who is poor. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Help a poor person, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who's a worker. Help a worker, a laborer. Help them with their labor, he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You can't help somebody financially, help someone with their labor. Aw tasna'u li akhraq. Or, yani, what is the meaning of akhraq? Akhraq is that person who can't do anything. It means it's a person who, الَّذِي لَا يُتْقِنُ مَا يُحَاوِلُ فِعْلَهُ. Whatever they try to do, they get it wrong. They try to put shelves up, they can't do it. Try to fix a cupboard, they can't do it. Try to do the plumbing under the sink, they can't do it. They're not too good at doing these things for themselves. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if you can't do any of these things, you can't spend in the way of Allah, you can do one of two things. Help a laborer, or help a person who, bichara, can't do anything himself. Help him. And that is a sadaqah for you, he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then Sayyidina Abu Dharr, he said, Ya Rasulullah, if I'm unable to do any of these things, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, "Takuffu sharraka 'ani an-nas fa innaha sadaqatun minka 'ala nafsik." If you can't do any good for people, then keep your evil away from the people, and that is a sadaqah from you, he said sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. So we learn from this hadith very important lesson. The greatest sadaqah in the way of Allah is, if a person is able to, is that which you give from your own wealth. That wealth which you have been given and you have earned, to give it in the way of Allah. If a person is unable to do that, the next sadaqah that a person can give is through the usage of their body. Through the usage of their body. And to help the makhluq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Inna lillahi ataya. Allah ta'ala has special gifts which he gives to chosen servants amongst his creation. And when those servants take those gifts and they distribute them amongst mankind, Allah Ta'ala continues to give them gifts to those people. Yani Allah Ta'ala gives a person wealth, physical strength, knowledge and wisdom. Whatever blessing they've been given, they continue to use it and spend it in the way of Allah. Give it in the way of Allah. Share it in the way of Allah. And as long as they do that, Allah will continue to give them and increase them. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi stop doing that. When they're sharing that blessing, Allah has given them, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah takes that blessing away from them and he gives it to others. So every ni'mah that we have been given from Allah has a sadaqah. It has a zakat. You have wealth, it has a zakat, it has a sadaqah. You have physical strength, that has a zakat and a sadaqah. Use it for the sake of helping the makhluk of Allah. You have ilm and knowledge, use it to benefit people. These are all things which we must share out to assist the makhluq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something I tell the children in madrasa, always ask them, what are you studying in college? What are you studying in university? Well, somebody says, I'm studying computer science. I'm studying technology. I'm studying biology. I'm studying this. And what reason? There's a good job. or there's a good wage, or anything like that. This is often the answer that young people give. And I always tell them, that don't do it because the wage is good. Do something which will benefit mankind. Do something which will benefit the makhluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which will benefit the world around you. All right, and then your every moment that you spend in your workplace, it is a sadaqah. It is a sadaqah. And it is with this niyyah that a person who goes to work in the morning, they should go to work in the morning with this niyyah. My amal that I'm doing today, whether I'm working as an accountant, I'm working as a plumber, I'm working as a tailor, I'm working as a dentist or a doctor, whatever I'm doing, leave the paycheck. Put the money to the back of your mind. And think about first and foremost the intention that your amal is a sadaqah for the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a sadaqah. You're fulfilling the command of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tu'inu saniya wa tasna li akhraq. Help people who can't do these things for themselves. Help them. And it is a sadaqah from you, he said sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And finally, if you're unable to do any good to people, you don't have the ability to do any good, you can't share knowledge with them, you can't spend in the way of Allah, you can't help the makhluk of Allah physically or do any of these things, what do you do? Takuffu sharraka anin nas. Save the people from your evil. Meaning what? Never let your tongue be party to speaking ill of a person. Never let your limbs be party to causing harm to another person. Never let your ears be party to hearing bad about another person. Protect people from your own evil. That is a sadaqah from you, he said. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Okay, we come to the next hadith, inshallah. Hadith number 118. Tafaddal.
عن أبي ذر أيضا رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم قال يصبح على كل سلامة من أحدكم صدقة فكل تسبيحة صدقة وكل تحميدة صدقة وكل تهليلة صدقة وكل تكبيرة صدقة وأمر بالمعروف صدقة ونهي عن المنكر صدقة ويجزئ من ذلك ركعتان يركعهما من الضحى رواه مسلم.
Allahu Akbar.
So Sayyidina Abu Dharr also reports that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, Sadaqah is owed by every joint you have. Every glorification is Sadaqah. Every praise is Sadaqah. Every La ilaha illallah is Sadaqah. Every Allahu Akbar is Sadaqah. Commanding the right is Sadaqah. Forbidding the wrong is Sadaqah. Praying the two raka'ah of duha, the forenoon prayer, takes care of all of that.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has told us the extent of gratitude which is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, yusbihu ala kulli sulama min ahadikum sadaqa. You will wake up in the morning and there will be due upon every single joint of yours in the body a sadaqa out of gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Idha asbaha saliman min al-afati baqiyan ala al-hay'ati allati tutammu biha munafi'uhu wa af'aluhu. When you wake up in the morning and your faculties are all sound, your eyesight is still sound, your mind is still sound, your body is still physically able to do what it wants to do, and you wake up in this very perfect, you wake up in this way rested and able to do as you was doing the night before, there is due upon all of these joints that you wake up with a sadaqah as a gratitude in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a sadaqah due upon all of that. As a gratitude. عظيمة شكرا لله تعالى على عظيم منته على أن الصدقة تدفع البلاء فوجودها عن عضائه يرجى دوام اندفاع البلاء عنها. The Imam says in the commentary that this is all, a sadaqah is due for every single joint in your body, and there are hundreds of joints in the body, but a sadaqah is due on every single one of them on the base as a shukr to Allah, number one, and number two, because the sadaqah dispels difficulties, it dispels bala, it dispels tribulations from you. So if a person gives sadaqah as a shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the faculties that they have been granted from Allah, yurja dawamu indifa'il bala anha, it is hoped that their body will remain salim, will remain sound and secure, and they will not have tribulations in their physical person because they are thanking Allah ta'ala constantly for that ni'mah by giving sadaqah upon those blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us. Yani we wake up in the morning in this state where our body and our limbs are, perfect. And it is such a huge blessing that we are negligent of. We wake up with simple blessings like health in our body. A huge blessing from Allah which we are negligent of. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, whoever wakes up in the morning and they have three things. Number one, they have food for the day. Qutu yawmihi. Number one, they have fi badanihi afiyah. They have health in their body, he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they have a roof over their head. Number three, they have a roof over their head. فَكَأَنَّمَا حِيزَتِ الدُّنْيَا بِحَذَافِيرِهَا. The Prophet ﷺ said, you have these three things, it's as though you have the entire dunya in your hands, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you have these three things. Allahu Akbar. These are huge blessings from Allah. A person wakes up in the morning, they are healthy. A person wakes up in the morning, we have food in the fridge. A person wakes up in the morning, we have a roof over our head. These are massive blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah said, this is the entire dunya has been put in your hands for you if you have these three things. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So therefore, we owe gratitude to Allah ta'ala upon these blessings. So every ni'mah, every joint that we have, a sadaqah is due. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explained, fil insani 360 mifsal. The Prophet ﷺ said, human beings have more than 360 joints in the body, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَعَلَيْهِ أَن يَتَصَدَّقَ عَن كُلِّ مِفْصَلٍ مِّنْهُ. The Prophet ﷺ said, you have to give sadaqah for every single joint. Now the question is, you got over 360, who's going to give sadaqah for over 360 joints? That means, at minimum, you've got to give something like, 360 pounds of sadaqah a day. Who can afford that? So this is what the Sahaba said. وَمَنْ يُتِيقُ ذَلِكَ يَا نَبِيَ اللَّهِ. Ya Rasulullah, who can do this? How can we give sadaqah for every single joint as a shukr to Allah? Look how the Prophet ﷺ responded. He said, أَنَّخَاءَ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ تَدْفَنُهَا صَدَقَةً وَالشَّيْتُ نْحِيهِ عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ صَدَقَةً فَإِنْ لَمْ تَجِدْ فَرَكَعَتَ الضُّحَى تُجْزِيكَ. The Prophet ﷺ said, no, it's not about the money that you spend, but any amal of good that you do, that is a sadaqah, which is a gratitude for the, it's a charity, and it is a gratitude for these blessings from Allah. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for example, if there is dirt in the masjid and you remove it, that is a sadaqah, which is a gratitude for the body that you've been given and the blessings that you've been given from Allah. Or if there is an obstacle in the way and you move it out of the way, that is a sadaqah, and it's a gratitude to Allah. Or if you pray two rakats of salatul duha after tulu' al-shams, the rising of the sun in the morning, and before zawal, you pray two rakats of salatul duha, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this will suffice you in showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of your limbs and for all of the blessings that you've been granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is how sadaqah is given on behalf of every blessing that we have and every limb that we have. It is not only through spending in the way of Allah, but it is through every amal of khair that we do, every good action that you do, helping a person, feeding a person, giving a person any assistance in any way. This is all a charity in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter if it's spending anything or not. All, any good action, kullu ma'rufin sadaqah, any good deed is a sadaqah. Any good deed for another person that you do is a charity, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is through that you are grateful to Allah. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explained, kullu tasbihatin sadaqah. Every time you say subhanallah, this is a sadaqah. Kullu tahleelatin sadaqah. Every time you say la ilaha illallah, this is a sadaqah. Kullu tahmidatin sadaqah. Every time you say alhamdulillah, this is a sadaqah. Kullu takbiratin sadaqah. Every time you say Allahu Akbar, this is a sadaqah. Amr bil ma'roof. Every time you incite people and you encourage people to do good, that's a charity, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every time you prohibit the evil, you tell people not to do bad, that is a charity, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَيُجْزِي مِنْ ذَٰلِكَ رَكَعَتَانِ يَرْكَعُهُمَا مِنَ الضُّحَى. And he said, two rakats which you do in salatul duha in the morning, that is enough, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Yani, it is enough for what? It is enough as a sadaqah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Instead of doing many different nawafil or many different optional forms of charity, a person can perform the two rakats of salatul duha, and those two rakats of salatul duha will suffice them from all optional actions of sadaqah in the way of Allah. If they cannot do anything else, those two rakats will suffice them from all other optional actions. As for the wajibat of the deen, like your zakat, which is fard upon you, salah, which is fard upon you, or any other obligations which are like serving our parents and in their elderly age, that's a fard. These types of fara'id, the two types of as two rakats of salatul duha are not enough for them. And nobody should understand from the hadith, the Prophet is saying two rakats of duha is enough, no problem. Throw your parents in old parents' home and read two rakats of salatul duha and that's enough. No, that's not the meaning. The meaning of the hadith is that those two rakats of salatul duha are enough if you can't do any other nafli, optional ibadat or sadaqah to Allah. Is it enough and does it make up for the obligations? It does not make up for the obligations. The obligations have to be done in their own way for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake. Okay, so these are the various ways a person can do charity. By dhikrullah, by the two rakats of duha in the morning, and also by assisting the makhluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, we come now to the hadith, the next hadith, hadith number 119.
الثالث عنه قال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم عرضت علي أعمال أمتي حسنها وسيئها فوجدت في محاسن أعمالها الأذى يماط عن الطريق ووجدت في مساوي أعمالها النخاعة تكون في المسجد لا تدفن رواه مسلم. Sayyidina Abu Dhar radiallahu ta'ala anhu also reports that the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam said, the actions of my community, both good and bad, were displayed before me, and I found among their good actions removing obstacles from the road, and I found among their bad actions spittle of nose in the mosque which is not buried.
Okay, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, all the a'mal of my ummah were presented to me. We know this is from the ilm of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Allah ta'ala granted him, that he was able and he was aware of the a'mal of his ummah. We know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us, tu'radu alayya a'malu ummati, your a'mal are presented to me. Fa in ra'aytu khayran hamidtu Allah, wa in ra'aytu sharran istaghfartu lakum. If I see good, I praise Allah. If I see bad, I see my ummah committing evil, I seek istighfar for them, he said sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So all the a'mal of the ummah are shown to him sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. And he said, I saw from the best deeds al-adha yumatu ani tariq, obstacles removed from the road, and from the worst deeds, spit, that a person, or phlegm, or you know, spit that comes, or you know, that which comes from the nose, which is on the floor of the masjid, which is not removed from that, he said sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. So we learn from this hadith that what, that from amongst the most beloved actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those a'mal which help and assist and benefit the makhluk of Allah. Hence, from the best actions of the ummah, al-adha yumatu ani tariq, obstacles and objects which are harmful removed from the pathway. Littering, therefore, is something which is not acceptable in Islam. Throwing rubbish on the roads, throwing rubbish on the streets, or creating obstacles in the way of people, and throwing something out and thinking, oh, it doesn't matter, somebody will get rid of it. This is not permissible, and this is against the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the action of the mu'min and the sadaqah that we should do is what? Remove obstacles from the road, not put them in the road. Lest you harm any makhluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even animals, and animals are cause extreme harm by people's littering. And it's incredibly, incredibly sad to see, people have no regard for this whatsoever. When lockdown opened up and people were just, we could talk about Nottingham, we don't have to talk about any other city. The Forest Park, Allahu Akbar, Astaghfirullah al-Azim. After lockdown was lifted, that park was covered from the top to the bottom in litter. Beer cans, crisp packets, sweet packets, absolutely any type of rubbish you could think of, the park was full of it. And it's a shameful and disgusting image. Honestly, the human beings, this is how they live. People who Allah Ta'ala has granted aqal, supposed to be ashraful makhluqat, this is how they live. They go and they dump their rubbish in the middle of parks and roads, and people have, bad habit, roll the window down, throw the bottle out of the window whilst you're driving, spit gum out of the car whilst you're driving, spit gum on the road. These are all bad habits which we need to get rid of. Obstacles to remove them from the road, that's the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's from the branches of faith, we will learn in the hadith which is coming, from the branches of iman, is to remove obstacles from the path, he said sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. I remember when I was in Egypt, there was a man, he used to lay down, he's addicted to drugs, Allah Ta'ala help him, grant him hidayah. He used to lay down in front of on the pathway, blocking people from crossing on the way to Azhar. He wouldn't let anybody go. He used to lay down, keep his feet high up, and nobody could walk past him, except without giving him money, so he could, you know, buy his whatever he wanted to buy and use. So he'd cause people a lot of trouble. And then, you know, when I was so you'd see him every day. One day I was coming back from Azhar, Masjid al-Azhar, walking back up, and he was there. There's an old lady trying to pass, and he was there, you know, stopping her way, shouting at her, stood up, stopping her way. He wanted money from her, he wouldn't let her go. So I pushed him to one side. Ya Rajul, la takallaf an-nas. I threw him, pushed him to one side, and my friend was with me. I said, you see this? Hadihi sadaqa, imatatul adha min at-tariq. The Prophet said, removing obstacles from the road is a sadaqa. I just did a sadaqa. So this is the meaning of, it doesn't have to be, you know, just removing rubbish, anything which is of harm to people, removing it from the pathway, that is a sadaqah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And from the worst actions is that people, what, they spit in the masjid. Now this is in the time of the Sahaba. The floor of the masjid wasn't carpet, it was what, it was sand. So they would sometimes, you know, saliva would go onto the floor if they would spit. Some of them were Bedouins, they weren't accustomed to the manners of the masajid. So they would come travel from outside of the city, come into the city. They didn't know the adab of Islam properly, and they would spit, and they wouldn't, after spitting it, they wouldn't put the soil over the top so it was covered. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is from the worst actions. So littering or spitting publicly, you know, these are a'mal which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam really did not like. So we should avoid doing these types of actions. And remember that they are against the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. May Allah ta'ala give us tawfiq. Inshallah, we will finish there. As the time for Maghrib is drawing close. Does anybody have any questions, inshallah?
Just a question about a hadith we did earlier. Bismillah. We said about making istighfar. So we know that from, for example, reading the Durood Sharif, we know that it removes 10 sins from the person who reads it. So in such a case, could someone suffice by just reading the Durood Sharif as a form of istighfar for them? Or should they separately make istighfar? Would that be better for them?
Either one is fine. We know that the Prophet ﷺ told us the salawat upon the Messenger ﷺ cancels out 10 bad deeds, increases you in 10 ranks, and gives you 10 good deeds as well. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that suffices. And we know that the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba, he was asked this question, a third of my time, half of my time, three quarters of my time, all of my time. And the Prophet ﷺ told him, you know, keep increasing your salawat, until he said, I'll do all my time on salawat. And the Prophet ﷺ said, that is enough for you in your dunya and your akhirah. So if a person was doing mulazam of salawat with that niyyah, that inshallah will suffice them. But istighfar has its own fada'il as well. So a person should select you know, to do that istighfar, even if it's three times after every salah, only that amount. Or even if it's, you know, 100 times daily, like for example in the Fajr time, وَالْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ بِالْأَصْحَارِ, those who seek istighfar in the Sahri time. This is mentioned in the Quran. So seeking istighfar also has its fada'il, which we should not deprive ourselves of as well. So there is without a doubt from the greatest adhkar is the salawat upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But istighfar should also, even if it's, you know, very small amount, but it should not be ignored, inshallah. Any other questions? There's another question here. When it says spend from what you love, does it mean just money or anything? For example, you might love a book, should you give it away? Yeah. It means specifically here, mal. It means specifically wealth that you love, you give that in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Specifically, that's what the ayah is referring to. But if a person gives away that which they love with the intention of sadaqah, inshallah, they'll be rewarded for that as well. Any other questions? Barakallahu feekum. We Fatiha for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the Ummah, and for the forgiveness of our sins in these beautiful days of Dhul Hijjah. Al Fatiha. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.